Hymn number 17. I sing praises. It's been loud today. I sing praises to your name. Burk's Branch, it's great seeing you today. Let's stand together. No other name. It's in your worship bulletin or on the screen. Giving us a spirit of fear, a spirit of peace in a time of fear. We magnify you. Amen.
Amen.
Be seated, please.
Good morning. Wow, that was weird, wasn't it? Not greeting everybody. Okay, so I have our mission moment today, and the theme is, it's all about the gospel. 1 Corinthians 15. Now, brothers, I want to remind you of the gospel I preached to you, which you received, on which you have taken your stand. By this gospel you are saved, if you hold firm to the word I preached to you, otherwise you have believed in vain. For what I received, I pass on to you as of first importance, that Christ died for our sins according to the scriptures, that he was buried, that he was raised on the third day according to the scriptures. We're looking at Day 3, Kirk and Karen Kirkland. I don't know what parent ever did that to their child, but. And so they are actually serving in Cincinnati, Ohio. Let me find his picture in this little thing first. Oh, this is the wrong one. Okay. Well, they started their church, they first went to Cincinnati in 2013. They started their first church in 2016, and now they're working on their second church plant in 2019. So Cincinnati has 2 million people of it. And the last survey that went through the area's most popular religion, with 56% reporting their most popular religion was no religion, no church. 56,000 people in Cincinnati do not go to church. Only 13% are affiliated with an evangelistic church, meaning a Christian church. And for those with unmathed skills, I figured that out for you. That means that 1.74 million people in Cincinnati do not believe in God. An hour and a half from our home here. They have one evangelistic church for every 10,000 people in Cincinnati. The North American Mission Board is looking to plant 77 new church plants. When I was looking at this this week, I looked up the church that Kirk is serving at, and he had a video on Facebook, and he was, of course, talking about the coronavirus. And I listened to what he said about their church response and what they're doing, and really his church was more, his message was, we have to take care of the people. There are these churches that are closed, there are people that are homeless, there are kids that aren't getting fed. How are we going to do? What are we going to do for these people? And he talked about, he read a verse, which I had to look up because he didn't quote the scripture, but it was Psalms 27:13. It says, yet I am confident I will see the Lord's goodness while I am here in the land of the living. How do people see Lord's goodness? Us. So he said, what is God asking you to do, is what Kirk said. God is going to use his church. Ask God's people, do what we are called to do, which is show his goodness. Thanks.
I will bless the Lord.
Yeah. Praise God. It's good to see you all here today as we come to give Him glory. Got to recognize two people here this morning. Sean is here with his fiancée, Macy. I told him I was going to embarrass him last week, and I forgot to, so I'm sorry. But y'all just say hello. Don't shake hands or hug or anything, but just say hello to them as you're leaving today. And then Lana's here with her grandson, Jackson, right? And she's got another, there's another smaller one, 4 months old, whose name is?
Sutton.
Sutton?
Sutton.
Sutton. Okay. And then, let's see, where's, Elisa's got a new grandbaby, whose name is Campbell Soup, right?
Yeah, you sound like Veronica.
Well, you know, we're both men.
Yes.
It was a little bit tiny when she was born, but doing all right, right? So praise God for new life, isn't it? We need to see some new life, don't we? From all the news and everything we've been having lately, it's just good to see everybody here as we worship today. It's a good time to come and pray. Pray for our country, pray for our neighbors, pray for each other, those that can't get out. Let's make sure we keep track of those who can't get out that we know about as we go through this time together. It's an interesting time that we can learn from, if nothing else. So let's learn what the Lord has to learn. It's kind of like back in the garden, though. It's they ate of that tree and they got a virus called sin. You couldn't see it right away. We can't see this virus either. It just comes on us, apparently. They tell us to wash our hands. Let's wash our hands this morning spiritually as we're worshiping here today. We got some folks that we need to pray for, and I'll try to remember everybody I got on here, but particularly let's remember the folks at the Masonic Home, Belma, Ms. Phillips, who's there, and our elderly parents, the elderly people in our congregation. Diane and I are over the age of 60, which is in the group, you know, that they've been saying, but we're trying to stay off the prayer list ourselves. Y'all do the same thing too. But let's just remember everybody that we got. So I won't go through everybody here, but we got lots of folks that we need to remember. But Deborah's Foster has a friend, Randy Ray, who has cancer, and his children are taking it particularly bad. So the whole family needs some prayers there for them. Touch Twice Clinic is not going to be what it normally is. They're going to have a drive-through, so they don't need all the volunteers, I guess. But, you know, if you need folks, know folks, and particularly now, maybe canned goods and the other things they can get going through the drive-through is more important than ever. So let's remember those folks also. Carolyn Barrett, did she have her?
She did, and she's doing real well.
And doing well, okay. That's
surgery she's had three.
Good deal. And so I think that's who I've got that's new. Is Christina back from Florida?
She's still in Florida?
Oh,
she's home. They're home. They got home last night.
Okay. let's keep Christina in our prayers, too, because she's probably in a vulnerable population, too. So a lot of folks like that that we need to remember this morning. Who else, though, do you have on your heart and minds that we need to remember here today? Yes, Tim. Okay. Elton? Elton. Ellison. I got hearing problems. Well, they call me Shorty too, but and I have hearing problems also. Ellison Crawford. Good. Okay. Mildred's under the weather. So lots of folks under the weather. Keith Paul needs our prayers especially, too. He called me up last night. He was quite upset, I think. I'll go try to see him today. Anybody else this morning? Yes, sorry. That's right. Is this the shame it took something like this to do it, isn't it? Yeah, that's right. Well, praise God. Well, let's go to the Lord in prayer then. Oh, Lord, we do come to you in prayer this morning, Lord. And Lord, we do think about the Garden of Eden where something that looked pretty innocent, just taking some fruit off of a tree, but infected us with a virus of sin, something that couldn't be seen. necessarily a death process that was put into process that we didn't know about, or we couldn't tell it physically at the time, although we did notice something that was wrong. And but Lord, you came down and you walked in the garden, and you made a provision for our sin with the you killed an animal and you gave us skins to wear. But more importantly, Lord, you looked to the cross and the day of the cross that would come. We are on the other side of that cross now, and we look back to you, Lord, with confidence that you're going to finish the good work that you've begun, the work not just in ourselves, but the work that you've begun in this world, Lord. And this is all heading towards a culmination when you come back to rule, when you come back to redeem us, when you come back to do away with all pain and suffering and all sin and all that is wrong, and put the world in right status again, in right place with you again, where then you can take your rest, which is when you're in control. We just pray for that day, Lord. But as we're praying for that day, Lord, we also, you tell us to lift up our leaders, and we do that all around the world, Lord, and it's a situation that nobody in modern times at least has been through, and all kinds of different things that come up that never would have come up in the past, and things to worry about and concerns. We just pray that there might be wisdom exercised, but also, Lord, that there might be a maybe the politics might get put aside for a while, and maybe the good of people in these different countries might be foremost. And we just think that's going on. We pray that's going on, Lord, in this country, but also in countries around the world. And then, Lord, there's a lot of fear. People are panicking. People are buying up toilet paper. People are buying up canned goods and milk and other things, Lord, and maybe a little bit irrationally, some of it. And we just pray, Lord, that where there's fear, it might be replaced with peace. With confidence, Lord, that people might turn to you. As Soren said, it's been declared a national day of prayer, and that's why we are here, and that's why we're praying this morning. And we just pray, Lord, that this country, we just pray that this world will take notice, will maybe look inside themselves, that they'll be honest with themselves, that they need a Savior, Lord, and that your Spirit might be able to work. Not just, Lord, physical healing, not just a cure for this disease, but, Lord, a cure for the disease of sin that you've already provided. We just pray that we might all take the antidote, Lord, which is your Son coming into our hearts. Help us as those that are on this side, Lord, that have accepted you into their hearts. We just pray that you might keep us calm. Let us keep our trust in you, Lord, and let us be an example, as Connie said, to those around us. It's in times like these, people need a Savior, and they need to see that Savior in us. Please do that in us here today, and as we leave here, Lord, and go to our homes, our work, or whatever, we may not be able to go much of anywhere, we don't know, but Lord, you can shine through us. And then, Lord, we want to lift up those that maybe are out with the flu today, or those that are out of concern. We have a lot of elderly members in our congregation, people that have compromised health already, maybe different heart problems or lung problems or different things, Lord, and we just lift each and every one of them up to you, that you might keep them from this virus, but also keep their courage and their hope up, Lord. And we just pray for health amongst all of them, but particularly at the Masonic home with Velma there and Miss Phillips there. We pray for Elizabeth in Romania. We pray for our elderly parents and those that are elderly among us, for Bill Flowers and Norman Tingle and Bill and Luina Moore. We lift each and every one of them up to you, Lord, and just pray that you will keep them whole through the midst of all this. Lord, for Leanne Ward, who is waiting for some tests, and Joy Pitts, who's waiting on a new lung, I believe. For Yolanda Hickman, Diane's friend that's had so many things go wrong and family members dying around her, that you might just give her hope and grace. For Diane's brother, Davis, as he's going through a bit of a rough patch now, Lord, but give him a sense of your presence, a sense of your peace. Keep all, Lord, needs you, your touch today, I think physically and spiritually. Kendall Richens, I don't know what this virus means for her and her situation and her having to be in the hospital, which is a terrible place to be when there's a disease going around. There's no better place to contact something like this. We just pray that you might protect her from this. Charlie Wilson and Jeff Summit out at the Masonic home, bless those gentlemen. Let them be a witness to each other and those around them also. For Paula Hernandez's mother, Joyce Barnes, touch this lady, Lord, and touch her in her body. Miss Denny, we lift her up particularly, Lord. She's so frail, so tiny. We would not like to see anything happen to her. Lord, folks with cancer, this has to be a time of a special concern for them. And we pray in each of these instances that you might just touch, that you might give a sense of peace. And Lord, we pray for healing. Jimmy Moffitt, Melissa Phillips, Johnny Baxter, and Alan Bruner, Teresa Vaughn, Tony Montgomery and Rosemary Braley, and now this new one, Randy Ray. We just lift each and every one of them up to those with diabetes. Not a good time for having diabetes either. Johnny Jones and Clifford Greer, Lord, touch them. Charlie Bill, this gentleman also, Lord, give healing there. For Lisa Hoy and Dave Kramer, we continue to bring them before you, Lord, and ask for healing there. For Christina, who's back from Florida, we're glad, but we just pray that you might keep her safe from this virus. And Emma, also to Kay and Michael, Christina's friends, a couple that were having health issues. Lord, for Candy, and she's waiting for her sinus surgery, and it's a ways off, but they're putting off surgery, so we don't know what that maybe means, but we just pray that you'll give Candy a sense of your presence and all that. For Mildred, as she's out and not feeling well today. And then for this uncle of Tim's, Elson Crawford, Lord, with his different issues, just give that man a sense of your presence. Gary Toombs, we're glad that he's doing well, that these tests are working. We've been praying for Gary. We just, Lord, that he might see you maybe in a new and a different way. And then for Mary Patton, who they've shocked her heart, and we just pray, Lord, that it'll continue to work well. Lord, for all the people that we're going to come to the Touch Twice Clinic and all the workers that we're going to be there, we're kind of looking forward to that, Lord, but we just pray that even as they can have to scale back and as they have to do things on a drive-through basis and that limits the contact, but even still, Lord, there's probably more people that have that kinds of needs for canned goods and food and other things, Lord. We just pray that in each of those situations, we're thankful for this community doing that. And we just pray, Lord, that those people might be blessed, but also it might just point them to you as they go through that line. For Stacy Hale, Lord, who I think is looking for a job and I think she's moved again, Lord, just give that lady a sense of presence and a sense of peace. And then little Carolyn Barrett, we're so thankful, Lord, that she's had her surgery, that she's doing well. And then, Lord, we rejoice with the Travises, with the birth of this new little baby Campbell Kate, and she's 5 pounds, 9 ounces, Lord, so she needs to gain some weight, and we just pray that she'll be healthy and happy. But we just rejoice in this time where we're hearing about so much trouble, so many things going on, and yet babies, Lord, are your way of saying, the world goes on, I'm still here, I'm still God, I'm still in control, I'm the one that gives life. So Lord, give us life as we sit here this morning. Lord, we just pray that we might have our hands washed, our spiritual hands, that you might cleanse us so we can be your people, so you can hear our prayers, so we can be a light in a time in which there's great darkness, and there is great darkness, so that we can, Lord, show the confidence of having a Savior to those around us who are living in fear. Lord, just walk among us here today. Walk among those who are at home that would be here if they could. Lord, touch each and every one of us. This is your church. We are your people, and we're grateful for that. Thank you, Lord, in your holy name. Amen.
Take the name of Jesus with you. We're going to stand. We're just going to sing the first and second verse. This will be our offertory hymn.
Precious name. we also pray that you be with Patrick King, that you would give him the word to continue to fill our hearts full of the love and knowledge of your son, Jesus. We just pray this in Jesus' precious name.
Amen.
Well, good morning, Burk's Branch Baptist Church. It is a delight to see you, not just because I came here really wondering how many faces I would see. And, you know, we're a little light today. That's all right. But also because last week I was away. And I felt that. I missed you all. I missed being here. I love you all. I can't wait till I can hit that red eject button and retire from the military and not have to be out there one Sunday a month. Today, although I've already, I hear you, some of you that have already expressed, oh, I'm so tired of hearing about all this situation going on, and I don't think that you have assembled here for another public service announcement, right? Has anybody managed to not hear about the coronavirus in the last week? Like, this is a shock to you? Like, what is this thing they're all talking about? Okay, good. So we're all on the same page. The NBA shut down, NCAA, Disneyland, probably the Yum Center, concerts. My school's canceled. Lindsay's school's canceled. Well, not canceled. I mean, they moved us to online studies. So this is affecting all kinds of stuff, and it does to some degree. You know, I think all of us are caught in the middle of feeling on one end like, oh my goodness, our land has lost its mind. And on the other end, God, how would you have us be responsible right now? And so if you got my letter, you read, and maybe you would have seen the video that I posted on YouTube and Facebook yesterday, which took forever to upload. But we've been trying to do our best. I've been talking with some of the leadership in the church about trying to keep everyone informed as to what we're doing as a church in response. And I don't want to talk at great length about the virus. I don't think that that's what you need to hear from me, from the Lord, or from His Word. But I do think that we have a responsibility right now to look at God's Word and ask the question, why are some churches even open today? Like this one. Given that our own governor kind of led the way, like our governor was the first that I'm aware of that said, hey, churches, why don't you all not meet this Sunday? Why don't you just close your doors? You all can do the virtual thing or, you know, handle church some other way. We have plenty of modern technology for you all to do that. And here we are. And yet we know, I mean, honestly, when I wrote the letter to you all about a week ago, I wrote that on Monday. And at that time, I was confident that 99% of churches would be open today. And then by yesterday, I would say, as best I can tell, it's about 50-50. And the interesting thing about that is we have about 50% of the churches that are normally open today. And there's a lot of people asking, here is my great concern. There are churches today that are closed saying, look at how irresponsible some of our brothers and sisters are being, keeping their doors open. And then we have churches whose doors are open, like ours, saying, look at how irresponsible these people are being, shutting their doors, closing the church. How dare they? And so what do we make of this situation? Because we are one body in Christ, the church. And the number one text that people are turning to for this puzzling question is Hebrews chapter 10. So if you would, please go ahead and turn in your Bibles to Hebrews chapter 10. And by God's grace, I hope to shed some light on what's going on in this text in order to understand better our response. And I hope that in coming weeks, I won't have to talk about this at all. But I think it would be irresponsible right now to not talk about this. So, we will be in Hebrews chapter 10, starting in verse 19. And actually, let me direct your attention down to verse 25. Verse 25 is really the crux of the matter. You will hear people quoting this, depending on the circles that you travel in. You will hear people quoting something. In my translation, the English Standard Version, it says, not neglecting meeting together, as is the habit of some, but encouraging one another, and all the more as you see the day drawing near, the day being the return of Christ. And so, right here, there is an implicit command for us to gather as the assembled church, not forsaking meeting together. Well, you could apply that in a lot of different ways. And I hope that you recognize that how you apply that really ultimately is a question of how are you obedient to the Lord? Because that's the ultimate question. It's not what so much what Burke's Branch thinks of Christianburg or some church in Simpsonville or Louisville. We answer to the Lord. And I had a friend texting me yesterday telling me what he thought I should do with our church. And I very politely thanked him for his thoughts and said, I am trying very hard to be responsible with this moment before the Lord. Basically saying, yeah, I don't answer to you, but I appreciate your biblical thoughts. But I will answer the Lord for whatever I do in this time, in this moment, and we all will. All right, so let me back up to verse 19. Hebrews 10:19 says, therefore, brothers, since we have confidence to enter the holy places by the blood of Jesus, and by a new and living way that he opened for us through the curtain, that is, through his flesh, and since we have a great priest over the house of God. Now there's three commands right here. Let us, number one, draw near with a true heart in full assurance of faith, with our hearts sprinkled clean from the evil conscience, and our bodies washed with pure water. Number two, let us hold fast the confession of our hope without wavering, for he who promised is faithful. And number three, let us consider how we may stir one another up toward love and good deeds, not neglecting meeting together, as some are in the habit of doing, but encouraging one another, and all the more as you see the day drawing near. Now I'll stop there for just a moment and draw out the fact that there's three let us, right? Let us do this, let us do this, let us do this. All of these, let us do A, B, and C, not neglecting meeting together. So these commands, which show up, are ultimately, at least in the mind of God, writing through the writer of Hebrews, in this moment, this is the purpose of our gathering. And of course, we could go to other texts that would speak to other aspects of what we are to do and why we assemble. And Jesus said, my house shall be called a house of prayer, right? When he was rebuking Pharisees and rebuking money changers for the way they were polluting the worship of God's temple, he said, my Father's house shall be called a house of prayer, which is why during the Sunday school hour, some of us assembled in here for prayer, which is why we, in the middle of our service every single week, we have this pause where we have like a prayer meeting in the middle of our worship service. That's very rare. But we take very seriously that God's house should be called a house of prayer. So I am going to get, essentially, I want to spend our time together understanding these three, let us do A, let us do B, let us do C. But first, I want to read the next portion of the text, because it gives us the results and consequences for those who forsake these commands. For if we go on sinning deliberately after receiving knowledge of the truth, there no longer remains a sacrifice for sins, but a fearful expectation of judgment and a fury of fire that will consume the adversaries. Anyone who has set the law of Moses dies without mercy on the evidence of two or three witnesses. He's just pointing to Leviticus. He's just saying, look, think back to the Old Testament. If you break the law of Moses, you die. All right? But now he's going to say something even worse happens here. Lost my place. Verse 29. How much worse punishment do you think will be deserved by the one who has spurned the Son of God and has profaned the blood of the covenant by which he was sanctified and has outraged the Spirit of grace? How many of you have ever thought about the Holy Spirit being outraged? Right? Like, that's not a picture I get in my head. Right? I think of the Holy Spirit is called the Comforter. And right here, I mean, the Spirit of grace being outraged. Wow. For we know him who said, vengeance is mine, I will repay. And again, the Lord will judge his people. It is a fearful thing to fall into the hands of the living God. Wow. Heavenly Father, I just want to ask that you would help your text to come through in this moment, that we would realize what on earth your word is saying to us, that we might not distort it in any way, but to hear clearly through your Spirit from your word. I pray this in your holy name. Amen. Now, how many of you would agree that that last portion, all that stuff that I just read, all the judgment and the outrage of the Holy Spirit and vengeance is mine, I will repay, fearful to fall into the hands. Like, how many of you would agree with me that that sounds a bit heavy, and that those words are like a giant blinking light? Take this seriously, right? So let me tell you what we could do, which I think would be a grave error, is to say, oh, you choose to forsake gathering together, therefore, judgment is coming. I don't think that's actually what's being said. It's actually, what's actually being said is, let us do A, let us do B, let us do C, because this is what God has created the church for. That what we have assembled for here, church, think about this, prior to the blood of Christ, prior to the new covenant, there was no church. There was Israel, and there was the rest of the world. And then suddenly, after the death, burial, and resurrection of Christ, after the day of Pentecost, the Holy Spirit comes on the believers, and the church is born. So who is the inventor of the church? Jesus Christ himself. Now, I've been told by so many people, you know, Ken, you don't have to go to church to be saved. Sure, that's true. You don't get saved by coming into a building. And you don't get saved by having relationships and friendships with other people. You get saved through Jesus Christ, faith in him and repentance over your sins. But generally, the person who makes that statement, it is an indicator that something is probably not right. Because we are also, while we are saved from sins, we are saved into the church. So to say, you know, you don't have to go to church to be saved. Well, true, it's not the process by which you're saved, but it is the thing that God invented for you to be saved into. And so I want to look at these three things, these three commands, to better understand why the church is so indispensable. Because what I would argue is that what Scripture is saying, all this terrifying judgment and you know, fearful falling into the hands of the living God, all this stuff is essentially saying, look, if you forsake the church, this is the danger that you are putting yourself in. If you forsake the value of the church, then you risk judgment. Well, that's a pretty extreme statement. Now, I want you to hear me very clearly. I do not believe that this is teaching that if you don't go to church on a particular Sunday, like today, people who have decided, you know what, I have a pretty lousy immune system, I'm taking all this stuff really seriously, I'm going to stay home. Does that mean that that person has forsaken the family of God? I would argue no. I have had friends who have told me that I've sinned. When I took Angela to Lake Tahoe for our anniversary, every year that we would do when we lived in California, we'd go up to Lake Tahoe for our anniversary, we'd spend the weekend up there, we'd go to the Shakespeare Festival, we'd have a great time, and we'd be there over a weekend, usually, and we didn't attend church on that Sunday. Now, maybe we should have, maybe we shouldn't. I mean, but I've been told by people, well, when you were in Tahoe, you should have found some fellowship up there, you know, some church event, church service to attend, because if you don't, then you're guilty of forsaking a gathering together. And I would say, I think that is an awful misrepresentation of this text. Because the people who were forsaking gathering together at the time of this text, you know why they were doing that? It's pretty well known that it was because of persecution. You get together and you become a target for the government that doesn't like Christians. So for them, the question was, it wasn't, oh, you know, if you assemble, you might pass diseases to each other. No, the question was, if you assemble, you identify with this body and you become a target for the government. And they may crucify you. How awful is that? So the question came down to, will you identify with Christ? Even if it costs you your life, will you identify with Christ? If you forsake the gathering together, if you forsake the church, then you forsake identifying with Christ. And I would argue that that is an everlasting principle. That if your life is marked by forsaking his church, we are called his body. You don't have to be a part of Burke's branch, but his church is his body. This is how we participate in Christ. So this is why it's so hard for churches to say, okay, well, you know, Governor, we'll go ahead and shut our doors and we'll just do this virtual thing from a distance from each other. I don't think that is a sin in a given week or perhaps for a short period of time. but I do believe it's dangerous, because I believe that what Scripture is about to tell us is that we desperately need each other. So let's get into it. Verse 22, let us draw near with a true heart and full assurance of faith, with our hearts sprinkled clean from an evil conscience and our bodies washed with pure water. Draw near to what? Isn't that interesting that it says draw near in this way, right? With a true heart and all this stuff. But draw near to what? Well, worship. Let us draw near in worship. The whole context of this, if we were to have started in verse 1 of Hebrews 10, and we see the flow of the argument, the flow of thought as the writer is writing the book of Hebrews, we would see he's contrasting Jesus all throughout the book. It's like Jesus is the greater Abraham. Jesus is the greater Moses. Jesus is greater than angels. And now here, Jesus is greater than the sacrificial system of the Old Testament. Think about it. Over and over and over, they came every year and provided a sin sacrifice, right? Like they bring this animal for the priest to slaughter, and they sprinkle all this blood everywhere. It's just this messy occasion, right? The Day of Atonement, Yom Kippur, and everybody's bringing their animals, and they're just oh my gosh, man, can you even imagine just cutting, and they have to do this over and over and over. Now imagine this. How many of you would like to get a statement from your credit card company? And they say, David, it's 2002, and your credit card balance is $20,000. And then next year, you get a credit card balance from your credit card. That's 2003, David. Happy New Year. And your balance is $20,000. It's 2004, $20,000, 2005, $20,000. And every year you're making payment after payment after payment after payment, but they are interest-only payments. And that balance does not change. Tell me that doesn't feel like prison. Tell me that doesn't feel like slavery. Scripture says that the borrower is a slave to the debtor, or to the lender. That's what the sacrificial system was. It didn't make a dent in our debt to God over our sins. They were like interest-only payments, just waiting and waiting and waiting for that day when Christ would come and say, boom, paid in full. It's done. It's 2020, and your bill says zero, David. Congratulations. It's paid. So that sacrificial system ends. This is what he's talking about when he says, draw near with a true heart and full assurance of faith, that you don't have a burden on you anymore to make these payments or to do anything to be made right by God, except to trust in the one who became the ultimate sacrifice. That's what the sprinkling refers to. That's what the washing refers to. Now, number two, verse 23. Verse 23. And let us hold fast the confession of our hope without wavering. For he who promised is faithful. You know, it's interesting how different our concept of hope is compared to the typical use of the word in the Bible. We would say things like, I hope it doesn't rain today, or maybe I hope it does rain today. Or we might say, I hope my kids drive safe. Or I hope Kentucky beats Louisville. I'm looking at you. Or I hope this preacher finishes soon. We hope for all kinds of things that we have no confidence in. We have no certainty. We don't, you know, this has been a rough year for Kentucky. Right? So when Scripture uses the word hope, it's usually referring to a confident expectation. This is our hope. And that doesn't happen, that kind of confident faith, that kind of confident hope doesn't happen as you just say, okay, I'm tired of being afraid. I'm just going to dig really deep and I'm going to hope. No, it doesn't work that way. I want faith, so faith. No, it just doesn't work that way. We can't just look inside of ourselves and give ourselves this motivational speech, this pep talk. Let me rile myself up like an inner cheerleader, just like encouraging. No, we gain a confident hope by looking at the object of that hope. You ever sat in a chair where you didn't even have to look at it, you didn't have to examine it, you know, you just plop down in the chair. Like, probably none of you looked at your pew and thought, are these legs still doing good? Are they still holding up? You just sat down. But have you ever sat in a chair where you're like, I don't know? Right? That confident expectation, that confident hope, that confident faith comes as we examine the object of our hope. And I believe that this is what is meant by confession. Let us hold to the confession of our hope. You know, for the first 300 years of the church, they had the Apostles' Creed, the Nicene Creed, all these different creeds and confessions that were coming out. And they largely all centered around the person of Jesus Christ. Who is Jesus? Because if we mess that up, we don't have Christianity. Right? And even today, there are places, there are people who either deny that he ever humanly existed, or there are people who deny, like, sure, there was a guy named Jesus, and he was a good teacher, but he wasn't God, right? Who and what Jesus is central to the Christian faith. So what is our confession about him? Just last night, we were having this like family devotion, which I don't want to sound all super spiritual, like we're this awesome Christian family that's always having all these amazing, you know, family devotions. We do our best, and we try to have like a weekly time where we sit down with this book and we're going through and we're teaching our children how to know the truth and who is God. And so we're going through this book. I think it's called Big Truths for Little Hearts or something like that. And so last night, we were discussing with our children that Jesus is fully God and fully man. And I got the chance to tell my children in this beautiful little dialogue with them about what I learned in this text. And really, it was from studying this text. In verse 20, it says, by the new and living way that he opened for us through the curtain, that is, through his flesh. That reference to a curtain, if we know our Old Testaments and if we know even the New Testament, if we know the gospel story, that there was this, in the temple, there was a very, very crucial curtain. And so if we were approaching the temple, we come to Jerusalem, and maybe it is, it's Passover, it's Day of Atonement, whatever. Like, so we're all arriving to Jerusalem. And then we get to the outer court where all of us commoners are allowed to assemble at the temple, right? But then there's like the actual building where the priests are allowed to go into the holy place. And then let's just imagine, I don't know, actually this works perfect. There's a curtain behind me. All right, so let's just say you all are in you're in the outer court. And then the stage up here, like this is the holy place. And you know, I go around and I light some candles and stuff, do all my priest stuff that I do. And I'm in the holy place doing all the holy stuff, right? But then there's this curtain. And behind that curtain is some really special stuff. Like the Ark of the Covenant. And what's inside the Ark of the Covenant? Oh, I'll tell you. There's a staff that Aaron had. It's like a walking stick. Only there was this funny day where that walking stick, by the command of God, started sprouting flowers. That's impossible. That can't happen, but it did. Also, Moses' Ten Commandments, you know, version 2, because he broke the first ones. These incredibly special items, holy items, from the memories of what God had taken the Israelites through, they all got put in the Ark of the Covenant. And then once the lid goes on the Ark of the Covenant and never to be opened again, and God says, my presence is right there. Only It's right there behind that curtain. And only one person even sees it, and only on one day of the year. So on the Day of Atonement, this priest, he goes in there, and behind that curtain does some other holy stuff that nobody ever saw. Only God saw. But here's the point. Is that curtain in the presence of God, or is it in the presence of men? Out here, there are priests doing X, Y, and Z. We can just call where you are the place of men, mankind. Out here, the place of mankind. But in there, that's all God. So let me ask you, is the curtain in God's presence or in man's presence? Isn't it amazing that it's both? That on both sides of that curtain, that on one side, that curtain is in the holy and glorious presence of God. And on the other side of that curtain, it's in the presence of men, and it's one curtain. And then here, isn't it interesting? He opened for us through the curtain, that is, through his flesh, this new and living way. So many people have asked, why was the curtain torn in two when Jesus died on the cross? Usually the speculation is simply this, that, well, now we have Jesus who leads us into the presence of God. He is the presence of God. So we don't need the Holy of Holies anymore. We don't need a curtain separating us from God. It can't even do that anymore because he completed the work of atoning for our sin that separated us from God. All of that's true. All of that's true. And it's awesome, right? It's beautiful. But there's more. He gave his life. He was broken for us. He was torn for us. So when that curtain tears, and he is the curtain, that is his flesh, how interesting that when he dies, the curtain tears. There's many points being made all at the same time, but part of what I had the joy of sharing with my children last night was that curtain is one picture. Because my daughter, Michaela, all of 8 years old, keeps saying, Daddy, I don't understand. You keep saying he's fully God, like he's entirely God, and he's entirely human. And even this morning, she tried to have a little Bible lesson with Titus, and she was explaining to Titus, so Titus, you see, you know, Jesus was part God and part man. And I said, nope. He is entirely, fully, 100% God, and entirely, fully, 100% man. Now, why am I beating this drum? Like, why am I saying all of this? Because this is the center point of Christianity. This is our bold confession that God took on flesh, not forsaking his divinity, but took on flesh so that the one who had all the power in all the world could say, I'm hungry. Or he could hang on the cross and say, I'm thirsty, right? Or as one person said, the one who holds the universe together by the word of his power grew in the womb of his mother even at that very moment, that as a fetus was somehow holding the universe together by the word of his power. Right? No one can explain that well enough to where we can finally say, ah, now I really get it. Because at the bottom line, end of the day, we are called to agree with Scripture, but we are not commanded to fully understand it, because these natures of Christ and the triune God that we worship are beyond our comprehension. And we ought to delight in that fact, because we serve a God who is so much bigger than our tiny little minds. And this is our confession. Now, church, how much have you heard Fox News talk about that in the last week? How much have you heard the radio talk about the fact that we are headed toward an eternal reality that makes this present time pale in comparison. That there is a judgment coming, which, even if you die from coronavirus, hear me, if someone in this room right now dies from the coronavirus, if you are in Christ, that's a blip. It's this little flicker of time, and then you are in glory. But for those who are not in Christ, dying from the coronavirus, that experience of losing your life to this disease, as awful as that may be, it pales in comparison to the judgment that follows. I don't think you're going to hear that on Fox News. You hear that here. And as I've had conversations, like I've gone to U of L, into their little common area where they have all their food court and all that kind of stuff, and I've had conversations with students. I had this conversation, I can't even repeat his name because it was Korean, and I it was really hard to pronounce. But I had this conversation with one young man, and it became very clear that as I walked away from that conversation, that was probably one of the only conversations he may have in his entire life about heaven and hell, life and death, eternal matters, because most of his life is consumed with studying engineering, playing video games, and hanging out with people who think about things like that. How to make money, how to have fun, how to find a girlfriend who becomes a wife, how to have kids, how to live a comfortable life, where to buy a house. This life, this life, this life, this life. And there are people who will go most of their lives never having had a conversation of eternal significance. And most of the students that I've talked to at U of L, I get that distinct impression. And the rare occasion that is not true, it's because I've encountered one who is actively a part of a local church. We desperately need each other to exhort and urge one another to not just think about this little problem right now. And yes, I'm calling the coronavirus a little problem right now. And I'm not trying to minimize the fact that it could take many lives. And the, you know, all the fancy doctors, congressional doctors or whatever, I mean, they're speculating, who knows, a quarter of America could wind up getting this, up to half? Millions and millions, like 100 million people getting a disease that will kill some of those 100 million. That is not a small thing. But what I cannot shake, and if you wind up watching the video that I posted yesterday, I would encourage it. I hope you will. And I talked about this in greater detail. But what I cannot shake is the reality that all throughout time, what Christians have done in response to an outbreak of a virus or a plague, Black Death, Ebola, you name it, is that they have run into the fire. They have run into the line of fire. They have run into the danger zone to care for those who were sick and dying. Because they recognize that, hey, my life, like if I die, what does that matter? If I die, I go to be with Jesus in glory and have joy everlasting forever. Right? Where there will be no crying, no tears, death shall be no more, neither shall there be pain, for the former things have passed away, and behold, he will have made all things new. But for those who die in their hospital beds without Christ and without someone lovingly coming into their presence to tell them in their hour of need that there is hope beyond this, no matter what happens in this hospital bed, that there is hope beyond this. That's what Christians have been doing for 2,000 years. When everyone in the Roman Empire was running away from the urban centers, these cities that were full of the plague, Christians were running in. So I don't know what's going to happen. I don't know if this whole craziness is going to make it to Shelbyville. Maybe it already has. But I am very seriously thinking about how we churches will respond. Because Worst case scenario, we could experience a time where the medical staff are not able to keep up with the demand. And I hope, oh, I pray that if that happens, that God's church is prepared to step up and say, we want to serve. We don't have trained skills. I mean, Lane does, but like most of us, we've maybe had a CPR class or in my case, like a self-aid buddy care, first aid kind of class through the military. But I got very little skills. Like I know how to patch up a bullet wound better than like somebody with a fever from an illness. But I hope that we would say, medical community, if you need us, the church is there. The final exhortation in verse 24 says, let us consider how we may stimulate one another to love and good deeds. That word stimulate, or in the ESV, I believe it said to stir up. Some of your translations may say spur on. There's a variety of different ways. But that word, it's only that word in the Greek, it's only used twice in the whole New Testament. And the other place, it's a very negative connotation. Paul and Barnabas are about to set out on another missionary journey, and Barnabas says, hey, I know Mark kind of like ditched us on our last missionary journey, but I think we should forgive him and bring him with us on our next missionary journey. And Paul was like, oh, we can't count on that guy. You know, he caused a lot of problems for us when he ditched us last time. And so they have this sharp dispute. And the word that's used there in the Greek is the same word. This is the only other place in the Bible that this word shows up, is right here. That we might stimulate, spur on, stir up. The word that I like is provoke. One person said, perhaps the most accurate translation for that word in this context would be, let us consider, church, as we gather, as we assemble, as we come together in homes or on the phone or here on Sunday morning, as we gather, let us consider how we may provoke one another to love and good deeds. Amen. That process does not sound like it's always enjoyable, right? Any of you want to be kicked with a spur? Any of you want to be poked by a prod? Any of you want to have to be provoked? But, oh God, may we be a people who provoke one another to love and good deeds and to an eternal perspective that puts everything in this life into its right place. Well, there's a few exhortations that I cannot avoid, and I'm going to close with this. There may be people in this room right now. Maybe for some reason you came here today despite the fact that you aren't really sure. If I were to ask you, you know, if you died today, do you believe that God would welcome you into his heaven? And you might say, I'm really not sure. I want to call upon you to escape the judgment that this text points us to. It says, for if we go on sinning deliberately, all of this is what is awaiting that person. Have you been sinning deliberately? As if God has not called you to holiness. I want to invite you to come forward, to confess sins, and to say, I'm ready to be forgiven. I'm ready to be sprinkled clean. I'm ready to be washed by the blood of the Lamb. I know that's weird Christian talk, right? But we do believe that Jesus does a special work inside of our souls. So come forward if you are feeling a convicting voice saying that you need to surrender your life to Christ. And I want to ask you right now to pull out a pen or pencil or something you can write with, maybe on your phone. And I want you to put down the name of one person in this church whom you will call this week. Because right now, and at every moment, with every circumstance, with everything that happens, in your life and in mine, in the life of this church, everywhere. This is a principle that doesn't, we don't escape anywhere we go. That at every moment, the circumstances of our lives, Satan is seeking to use to destroy us and tear us apart, and God is seeking to use to grow and develop us. So, the reason I want you to write down a name of a person in this church is that we might take this opportunity provided for us through the coronavirus to actually deepen our fellowship with one another, to improve our sense of community in our midst, our fellowship, rather than allowing this to slowly isolate us. So please write down a name of someone that you are going to reach out to this week, someone you will call, and I want you to ask them, how is your heart? How is your soul? How is your faith? Christian fellowship is not simply saying, hey, did you see, you can't talk about sports anymore because there's no sports, but Christian fellowship is not merely socializing with one another. It is reaching out to one another in order to exhort each other and to be all the things that I've been talking about. And you don't have to assemble on Sunday morning to do these, although there is a special opportunity that takes place here. But I want to exhort you to take your own responsibility for fostering a deeper sense of community in this church than we had before the coronavirus even showed up. So that's an action point and a takeaway. Pastor Mark, would you mind coming back up and leading us? And if anyone here, if you are feeling the conviction of the Lord to surrender your life to him, I'm going to stand down here and I plead with you to escape the potential judgment and to come forward seeking to surrender your life to Christ.
545. Let's stand together.
Sunday singing. Once again, it's March 29th, 6 p.m. in Dover. I'm sure right now it's still a go.
Let's go until we know it's not.
Until we know it's not. So we'll be planning on that. Other than that, I don't have any more announcements. Do you guys have things I need to, we need to share with one another?
I have two slides. Nobody else? Okay. So my wife wanted me to just remind everybody, if you signed up for further information regarding serving in the children's ministry here, please keep an eye on your email, because we are kind of shifting to getting information out that way as opposed to more face-to-face stuff. So she's put a lot of work into the first email that she either just sent out or is sending out. But anyway, I read it and it was really good. The other thing is, anybody from the leadership team, if you're a deacon or Pastor Mark, if you can just stick around after church for a really brief meeting to discuss a few things, I appreciate that. And that's it.
Okay. One other thing I was thinking of, what Brother Kim was talking about at the end of his sermon was, everybody write down a name, or remember this week to try and call somebody. I'm thinking this really is a time of darkness for us, but I think we're called to be light. So we need to think about how can we be light? What do we need to be doing? We need to take care of one another, and then from that we can move on. So calling somebody within this church is really, really important. And it may be, we're missing a lot of faces today, a lot of very faithful faces. Call, hey, you need anything? You need us to run an errand for you? You don't need to get out? You've got some stuff going on, you don't need to be out. So we need to be very aware of that. And I don't know how to do this and organize it, but if somebody can contact the church, hey, one of us get in touch with us, we'll go run that errand. So that's us supporting one another, and that's what Christians do. So I just really, really think that's important that we do that right now, and we show that we're the light of the world.
Amen.
That's it for my soapbox topic. Birthdays and anniversaries. Any anniversaries? I know there's birthdays. Is there an anniversary?
Birthday.
Oh, we got birthdays. Lucy's birthday.
All right.
Is it your birthday? When?
Tomorrow.
How old are you?
10.
No.
Tomorrow.
10.
And Sean's birthday today. How old are you going
to be? I'm 22.
22. Anyone else? If not, we'll sing happy birthday. Thank you.